everyone. So we're gonna get this rolling. Today we have Isela Borroel, VP of Engineering, who will be giving us an introduction about what is WiseSign, WiseSign Academy, and all the challenges that are coming for WiseSign before we get started with the talk. So Isela, the mic is all yours.
Hi, hello, good afternoon to everyone. I am pretty glad to be here with you. And I would like to tell you, welcome to WiseLine. WiseLine Academy is a way for us to transfer knowledge and to help other people to increase their level of experience. And in this case, we are going to start with the series of PHP training, and we're very happy with that. Right now, we have a lot of opportunities to grow in the company. WiseLine is a company that is focused on a service to develop software. And we are in a very, very prosperous stage of our life or maturity of the company, where we have to grow in a very accelerated way, scaling the company. So we really, really, really want that each of you take the best learnings from Jacob, Barry, and also with Jack Bravo, and that you can apply it in your companies in order to grow and to deliver better software. Thank you very much for being here. And if at any moment you have any question, please feel free. This is a free environment. In order to resolve any doubt, don't take the doubts and hide them. Please expose them. And I am pretty sure that if you ask these questions that you have in your mind, you will be improving in your craft. So thank you very much. Have a very good training sessions. And we are open for all of you to keep in contact. Bye-bye.
So, hi, everybody. Let me just switch to share my screen. 1 minute, please. So here we are. So welcome, as Isela told you. PHP Academy is very happy to welcome you today. And we're doing this workshop, today's workshop, in partnership with PHP Jalisco, a group focused on PHP in the Mexican state of Jalisco. My name is Jacob Remperi. I'm a software engineer here in WiseLine. I specialize on backend, do a little front end, but pretty much do a lot of PHP, JavaScript, and currently blockchain technology. This is the agenda of today's workshop. We're gonna be working with Laravel 8, which just came out a few weeks ago. So pretty excited of showing a few changes that are in the new version. And well, anyway, we're gonna start with setup and structure. We're gonna kick off a new app directly from zero. We're gonna look at the folder structure, how the command line interface works, and start a local server for development. Then we're gonna set up our initial routes, controllers, views to manage our requests and responses. And after we have a basic working app going, then we're gonna put another layer of complexity on top of our app, and we're gonna add some database and authentication functionality to it, and mess a little with sessions and user models. At the end, we're gonna have a quick Q&A where you'll be able to ask any questions you have, but feel free to drop any questions during the lecture. We're gonna see that in a second as well. The rules of the workshop, or how we like to run things here, is that you have your Zoom session completely identified with your name. To mute your microphone all the time, please. Don't interrupt unless it's something really important. You can use the chat for questions here in the Q&A. Also, if it is a blocking question you have during the workshop, please ask it immediately, and And I will be happy to clarify anything that is blocking you from going forward. Obviously, try to focus your questions on the presented topic. And if you have connection issues, feel free to turn off your camera. But if not, we'd like to see you. So please keep your camera on. And the code of conduct, be respectful. There are no bad questions or ideas. Be welcoming and patient, and be careful in the words that you choose. We try to have a very inclusive and respectful environment here, so we can only achieve that if everyone is in on that. So we're gonna start coding time. Let me switch to my terminal. I have an empty directory here, and what we're gonna do is we're gonna run Composer to directly create a new project. This is the command we're gonna use, Composer create project, prefer this, Laravel. This is gonna give us the latest version and the latest release, the latest stable release. And we're gonna call it Laravel 101. So we're gonna let Composer do its magic. It takes a little while. It shouldn't take too much because I've been working on this, so I have a lot of the packages already on cache, but pretty much it's gonna start on it. I think I can start already to open the folder here. Yeah, I have it here. It already copied like the base files, and then it's gonna start installing all the dependencies that Composer needs to run. Let's see how it's going. Okay, awesome, it's finishing. So we're there. We have the folder, the Laravel 101 folder. And we can see that we have the base folders. To kick things off, we're gonna start already starting our local server. So we're gonna use this beautiful, I really love this this tool from Laravel, that is the artisan command. And it pretty much, if you click enter without doing anything else, you're gonna see a list of the different commands we have access to in the framework. And we have this very pretty quick command to start the server, which is PHP artisan serve. And we have a server running with PHP and everything we need there. If we go to the website, we're gonna see the default welcome page. So we have the app running, it's working perfectly, and we have access to all the files. And I wanna give a quick overview of the folder structure of the app. This is how it's constructed by default. There are a lot of folders, obviously the vendor folder we don't want. If anyone is coming from the JavaScript world, this is the equivalent of the node modules folder. This is where all the dependencies are installed. So we're not gonna dig into it because it's huge. But we have our other folders. The app folder is pretty much where all our logic is in, where we're gonna be writing our models, our controllers, any middleware, any service injection, everything that we do to the logic and the processing of the data, mm-hmm. both requests and responses goes here. The bootstrap folder meddles a little with the services we're using, but a little less than that. Let me check the chat because it's going crazy. Thanks, Barry. Pretty much how Barry explained in the chat to use that. I hope it works for everybody. I'm also gonna add to the chat, this is the GitHub repo of the project I'm gonna be building. So you can have access to it even if you have any problems coding at the same time, you can follow it in the repo, and you can download it later if you want to. So going back to the folders, we have the bootstrap folder, and we have the configuration folder. We have different aspects of the app. We can do some configuration here. These are pretty much arrays that accept different values for different keys. And for example, like the name, like some of the things you can set up in the environment files. And that's pretty much it. It's pretty simple, pretty straightforward. The database is where all your migrations and the seeders and factories, if you want to have some seeder set up for your database or things like that, you can do it here and set up your migrations. We're going to do some migrations at pretty much at the end of the workshop. What I would like to do right now in the database folder is to go database and to create the database file I'm going to be using later. This is just a quick step, but we're going to be doing everything on SQLite as well, because we don't need like big response and a powerful engine. So this is a quick app. So we're going to be working with SQLite. And the public folder, the beauty of Laravel, or where the main focus of its security lays, is that this is the folder where your web server is going to be pointing to. So there is nothing exposed there of the logic and the environment files or anything to the web server. The bootstrapping file that it gets executed when you access the website is the index.php in the public folder, and then it does all the loading from the files below it. So the URL, the root URL of your website will be to the public folder. It's pretty useful. The resources folder is pretty much all the front-end stuff, where you get your views, you get all your assets like JavaScript, CSS, and everything else like that, and the whole localization files. The root, you can have different ways to access your app. So you have API, you have web, the console allows you to create command line interface commands, and pretty much that. Storage is for image loading and things like that, your test, and the vendor we already spoke of. The M file, it has a lot of possible configuration. I don't use that much. And I actually gonna copy a starting information of what I need. And this is pretty much what I use. For the mail working, I'm gonna be using MailTrap, which is also pretty useful. And SQLite, as I said, and that's pretty much it. So to get the app started, what I wanna do with this app is consume an API. I chose the Poke API because it's pretty simple, pretty straightforward, has no limits, and it's easy to set up. So we're gonna be doing that. And for that, we're gonna be creating a controller first. As I said, the artisan command is pretty useful, and we do have a command in the command line to create a controller from scratch. And it's like this. Every time you want to use a command in Artisan, you do have the flag for help, which can give you more detailed information about I'm in the database folder, sorry. Make controller, you have the help flag, which gives you detailed information of what that controller does, what flags it also accepts, and what you can do. As you can see here, we do have to provide a name for the class, but we also have all these options. Since this is an API consuming controller, I'm gonna make it a resource controller, which already gives me from scratch all the HTTP verbs set up as methods of my class. So it's pretty useful. So I'm gonna call it a resource controller. Sorry. And I'm gonna be calling Pokemon controller. It's already created. If I go to my editor, app, HTTP controllers, I can see my controller here. And as I told you, we have already all the verbs we would need to show a resource or to edit it, to interact with resources. Since this is a very simple app, I'm gonna delete most of the methods. I only want to the index, which lists my resources. The show as well, and pretty much all the rest I'm gonna delete. So we're just gonna be using the index and the show methods. The HTTP client I'm gonna be using for consuming the API is already installed and comes bundled with Laravel. It's the Gozle HTTP Gozle package. So what I'm gonna do is I'm simply gonna be calling it in my controller. That's the route to get the facade here. And Laravel works with facades, and you also have the option to do service injection to work these kind of things where you want to get the functionality of a different module or a different service inside your app. The service injection is super useful, but I'm not gonna go in depth into that since we're just doing a 101. But it's something worth looking into afterwards if you want to. So when I come here, I'm just gonna be looking into the response. I'm just be calling a response variable, and I'll be doing the call. Since I'm already calling the helper completely by its namespace, I already have access by it with its own module name. It's a get verb, and I will be getting, for example, I just want to be getting Pokemons. So I will be calling this URL. And I do have to, I'm gonna get a JSON response. So I do want to decode it. So we get the JSON response, the body of the response. And I will be just looking at the data to make sure that I'm doing everything all right. Okay, so I have the method done. And what I need to do now is create the route so we can access this. Okay, we have the web routes, and we already have a route get function, a closure that returns a simple view as default. But we don't want that. We want the route to go to the controller and to its method. So we're gonna remove this, and we're gonna tell it that if the request is a get request to our route, we want it to access the, oh, I'm sorry. I do have to set up the controller here. I could use here and set up the ultimate, the complete namespace for the controller, but I do like to leave the controller, since I would be using a lot of controllers in here, I do like to leave it open as controllers to use the namespace, and then in here, call each one of the controllers I might use. So we have the Pokemon controller here. We make sure we're calling the class. And this array has to, as second parameter, receives the method we want the request to go to. So it's pretty much done. If we open the website, we'll be getting the response we got from the Pokemon API. As you can see, we have the results 20 as result, so we can play now with the data. What we can do now, I would like to get a little in depth. We're not gonna be completely doing this, but the front end is also very useful to go into. So what we're gonna be doing here is going into the resources and the views. We only have the welcome view, but I do like having a more granulated view thing here, like the structure. So I'm gonna go into resources views. We have the welcome view. I'm gonna create a directory for layouts. And I'm gonna create the, I do like to create my views in relationship to my controllers. So I'm gonna create the Pokemon index. Laravel uses the Blade templating engine. So all your views have to have the extension of Blade.php. And in the layouts folder, I always create a general layout view, which would have like the skeleton of the view of the page, and then leave it open for different modules or view modules to lay foundations there. So I'm gonna create the Poke app, which will be my general layout. And I'm also gonna create a header and a footer file. Okay, now if we go back to the editor, we can set up the main layout file. No, I'm sorry, it's this one. I'm just pasting the whole thing because it'd be cumbersome to type it all. But just to make it like a quick review, we have this yield and include directive. This comes from the Blade engine and allow us to inject content in the main template. So when I call a view from my controller, I'm not gonna be calling the main Blade view. I will be calling the one that uses the content, which will be extending this view. The include directive, it just means that it will be pulling specific files, and the way the Blade templating works, is that you get the folder, and instead of a slash, you put a dot, and then the name of the file without the extensions. So we can go to the header. I'm just gonna paste the main stuff. This is the way I want it to look. It's pretty simple, and it uses Bootstrap. So there is no big thing here. And then the footer, we're gonna also do a little nod to Wiseline and to PHP Jalisco. And we're gonna go next to the index, the place where I want to show the whole thing. Give me a second to just paste this. Then this. That's pretty much it. Then we're gonna end with an end section. So the way this works, I will be calling this file from the controller. It says it extends the main layout file. It gives a value to the title section, which we saw in here, where you yield some content. And I'm also gonna be looping through the data we got in the controller. So we're expecting here a data variable with the results, which is pretty much what we got in the, as you can remember in the JSON body. This is the results property, and we can work with that. So we go to the Pokemon controller, we delete this display die, and return the body. We already have the data we want to display, so we're just gonna return view. This is a global method. You don't have to initialize anything like that. And specify which view we're gonna be talking about, which in this case is the Pokemon index. It works like inside the blade views that you don't have to specify any extension. And as a second argument, we can send data in form of an array. So I'm gonna be sending the data variable, and it will be containing the JSON response variable. Now, if we go to the website, we can see that it now works. Okay, so this is the basic app. This is what I wanted to do as a basic app. Consume the API, and maybe also we're gonna be creating a details page where you can go see the Pokemon data. Right now it's not doing anything, but the links are broken. There is no route set up for that, but we're gonna be creating it next in the show method we already left in the controller. Okay, so we have our show method, and we will be getting, instead of an ID, we're gonna be getting a slot. I want to receive, since that's how the Pokemon API works, I want to mimic that and do something like that. So I will be accepting a slot or a lowercase name for the Pokemon I will be displaying. And the slot we will be receiving, it's pretty much how the API works as well. So if we go here and want to see a Pokemon, we can see the data or the details for that specific Pokemon, just sending the slot to the same URL with this in the last URI. So let me go back to my website. So what we'll be doing is the same. We'll be calling the API, getting a response as well. And oh, I'm sorry, we'll be getting it. And to make things a little faster, I'm just gonna paste the URL. So we have it here, the response, the JSON response, the JSON decode, the response body. And we can do a DD of the JSON response. I'm making a mistake on purpose on the URL. So you can see something very useful in Laravel as well, is that when you mess up, you do, oh, I'm sorry. I have to set up the root. If you don't set up the root, the error page is not as informative. But we're just getting also we have to set up, it's gonna be get. I want to name it Pokemon and then getting the slot. Okay, this is how you set that you will be receiving a specific property as part of the URL. And the rest is pretty much the same. A second parameter, we send the controllers, Pokemon controller class. But instead of an index, it's the show method we'll be using. So if we go there, this is the error page when you mess up with something. Like a 500 error. If you're in development mode, you have debug on, you get this screen in Laravel 8, and it's pretty, pretty useful. It's awesome. I love it because I mess up a lot. You have all the stack trace of the error, the complete stack trace. You get where the error was thrown exactly. Sometimes it's not that useful because you're seeing that in the code of the vendor that actually threw the error, but you have the whole stack trace so you can see where exactly that you messed up or where in your code it actually messed up. And let me check for, anyway, somewhere in there is my controller doing the request to a bad URL. You also have access to details of the request. You have access to environment variables. If the authentication is on, you have access to the user data, context. Well, there is a lot of information there to debug what the problem is. So it's pretty cool. I really like it. And let's correct the problem, the error I did, which was giving it a wrong URL. And if we do that, we get the response. So we're getting the response from the API, and it works nicely. And now we're gonna make a view for this specific part of the website. So as I said before, I like naming my views like the controller method I'm using. So I'm gonna copy the same view I got because it will be extending the same view. And well, in this case, it's not that big, but just to speed things up. And it's gonna be Pokemon show.play.php. We have that there. Okay, let's go to it. It extends the same layout file, so we don't care. And in here, we can do something different like Pokemon. Since we'll be sending the same data variable we have, and we can see that we have this property called name. Here you have it with the name of the Pokemon. I'm gonna be naming it like data name. And for the content, Pokemon details, maybe exactly the same. Name. And just do a, something very cool also from late is that not advisable, obviously. But if you need to do any PHP logic inside your view, please don't. But for debugging, for testing something new or whatever, you have the PHP section available in Blade as well. So you can run PHP code directly here. So I'm just gonna be calling the data variable to be dumped here. I'm sorry, please mute your mics, please. Anyway. Okay, thank you. And with this, I'm just gonna be, I forgot to call the view from here. Let's remove this and return as well the view. Pokemon show and the array data. Okay, so if we go here, we're gonna be seeing the same. It's calling the header, it's calling the, well, at the end it's calling the footer, and it's dumping the whole data stuff here. So it extended the same view, it works nicely, and I like it. So this is now completely the base app I wanted to show you. And for the other stuff, I thought it'd be cool to add a little more interaction. And we're gonna add some authentication and database functionality. For, let's say I wanna create an account into the Pokemon list website and to choose which is my favorite and to have access to it. First, we're gonna be doing some pagination because there are a lot of Pokemon to choose from. And I think it'd be nice just to do a little pagination. As you can see, as you, I don't know if you saw in the PokeAppy, you have access to limit and offset variables. So we're gonna take advantage of that and do some pagination. And we will be accepting that in our controller as well. For all the methods you do, you have access to the request by accepting it as a parameter of your method. So if you set it up like this, you have access to the whole request, which includes get, post, variables, the whole server variables, like the IP of the client, version, whatever, browser, all that kind of information. So we're gonna be setting a few variables here. If we're getting an offset variable in the request, I'm sorry. If we're getting that, I'm gonna be using that. And this method also gives me the option that if we're not, then give me a default value, okay? For the limit, I don't know if you took a look, but in the environment file, I set up a new variable called Pokemon list default offset. I'm sorry, it should be limit. But anyway, this is the account. Let's change it. I think I'm confusing a couple things. Yeah, it's the limit. We'll be using the limit, the count of Pokemons we're gonna get per call. I don't like hard coding things in the controllers, so I set it up as a environment variable, and we're gonna be using that for the default in this case. So the limit will be the value of the variable if we are getting it as a get variable, or access to the environment variable is pretty quick, pretty straightforward. And we just call the end method and set up specifically the variable we want to use, or as default, both the end method and the input method accept default values, but we're going to go with input as well. So if we didn't have this variable, I also can do it here that, okay, if we don't have the variable, then do it like 100. But in this case, we do have it, so it's gonna be using that. And we'll be calling this for the request. So there we are. And I want to give some pagination information to the view. So I will be also sending a pagination array, which will be previous. The data we get from the API lets me know if there are some previous or next data. So I'm going to be using that just as a flag to know if there is data I can ask or not, instead of doing something internally more complicated. This is just for the heck of doing something quick. So if it isn't null, I'm going to get that Boolean. I'm going to validate for this. And also for the next. And for the, I'm also gonna give it the limit value. And the offset value. And I'm just gonna be sending this as a as another variable for the view. And in the view, I'm just gonna be adding the buttons in case we do have pagination. Okay, it is very straightforward. I'm not gonna go into a lot of detail. It's a little patchy, hacky way of doing pagination, but it works. So if we go to the website again, we're gonna see that we don't have a previous because we're at the start, but we'll be getting pagination afterwards. As you can see in the URL, the offset is changing, so we got everything working fine. The Pokemon APIs has 1,050 Pokemons. At the end, we don't get a next button because there is no more data. But so you, I think a favorite Pokemon option would be cool. So we'll be creating the authentication and the database stuff, okay? To be able to choose favorite Pokemons. So we're gonna go first to add authentication. Laravel 8 has a new way of doing this. This is completely new. Before Laravel 8, the way to make authentication was an artisan comment that was make auth. But in Laravel 8, they have done an amazing job because the whole authentication module you can install, it's called Jetstream. It's a package separated from Laravel. It's not already included, but has a ton of functionality. Out of the box, you already have two-factor authentication, password reset, and email verification, password change, profile picture, dashboard you can tweak to your liking. So there is a lot of stuff already done for you that you don't have to worry about. So the first thing to create the authentication, we already have our database set up. As you saw, I created the file and set up the end file, the environment file. I set it up for SQLite. We're gonna do a couple tweaks first that help us do this. But first we're gonna create the package. I'm sorry. Okay, so we're gonna create the package. Let me get out of the resources folder. We're in the root of our application and we're gonna do a composer require Laravel Jetstream. When we do that, same as when we created the project, it's gonna download all the packages, it's gonna install all the dependencies, and we're gonna do a couple tweaks. They're not bugs, but the developers have reasons to not do this by default, but we have to do a couple of tweaks first. So I'm going to go into the app providers folder to increase the string length, the default string length for the database tables. Okay, so I'm gonna go to the app service provider. Just add. I'm gonna add a facade to use, and in the boot method, I'm just gonna do this. That's it. That's the trick I did want to do. It's a little hacky, but didn't want to do it behind the scenes so you can see if anything goes wrong on your side. This is one of the reasons sometimes setting up authentication may fail in Laravel. And after that, let's check if the packages are installed. They are. We're gonna do a quick migration, PHP Artisan Migrate. What this is gonna be doing is that if we go to our database folder migrations, we have all these migrations set up by default out of the box for Laravel, and they include creating the users table, the create password, the password recovery table, and for failed jobs. For Laravel has also a queues and job queue functionality that works with this. So we're pretty much gonna install those, set up those tables in our database SQLite file. Once we have that, once we have that, then we're gonna use the command line to set up the rest of the of Jetstream. Once we install the package, we now have a Jetstream command, which installs. You have two options for Jetstream, which is pretty much how the front end of the auth setup works. And the fastest one is Liveware, but you also have access to another one called Inertia. It's you should take a deeper look into all of this. So I'm gonna run the command. It's gonna install it. And after that, since we're gonna be messing a little with front end in this case, we're also gonna be doing an NPM install and run an NPM command. But there you go, it's installed, everything is done. And we're gonna do the NPM install. And npm run dev. This will install all the JavaScript and pretty much all the front end dependencies. And and the run dev is going to be doing all the all the mixing and setup for the assets, like mixing the CSS and the JavaScript files for production and things like that. So it does take a little while, but not too much. So once it's done, after this, we're just gonna be doing another migration with all the things we got installed from the Jetstream. And then we're ready to have our authentication module. It's gonna be ready to go. We're done, it's already installed. So I'm just gonna be running another migrate. It added a few other tables, the two-factor, create personal access token, create session table. So we're done. We have the authentication set up. And the only thing we do have to do by ourselves, which is not done automatically, is create our authentication routes. Okay? I'm just gonna be copying and pasting them, but they're pretty much set up. No, I'm sorry. I think it's created. Yeah, it's created automatically. What I do want to create is the email verification routes. I just sent a dummy message in the chat, sorry. These are the routes for email verification. This functionality is that when someone signs up, I do want them to verify their email before they can access the system. Okay, so with this, I make sure that we're working with a specific email, and that email is indeed valid. To do this, we're gonna go to the user's model, which was created out of the box too. Oh yeah, for the API, if you go to the Laravel documentation, you do have access to the different authentication methods they support for different app aspects, okay? So in here, we already have the must verify email class set up here. So we're just gonna be implementing it. We implement that, we do the routing, and I think it's pretty much that. Yeah, it should work like that now. So I'm gonna be adding a couple new things to my header just to have quick access to the authentication links. As you can see, we also got a few new folders and files in the resources views folders. They were all created when we added the authentication module. So in here, we're gonna be adding this. It's a conditional that if the user is logged in, we just add a link to the user dashboard. And if it isn't, we're gonna be showing login and register links in the website. So we have this here. We have login and register. If we go to login, it's a template thing, view. And if we go to register, we can register ourselves. We can use some email. I think Laravel has a minimum for passwords of 8 characters. And I think it's gonna break, but I'm not sure. Let me check. So we got this here. As you can remember, I set up MailTrap as my email client to check for this. So I got the email, but I'm just gonna show you here. This was the thing. Let me check. I remember I had this problem before, but call to undefined method, support facets, request use. Oh yeah, this is happening because in the routes, I set the routes correctly, but I didn't, just give me a second. For the routes, I didn't set up to get requests. So when I go to the web router, I do have to set up this too. I was getting the error here, but I didn't see it. But that was the problem. So if we go back to the app, and we do want to resend the email, the verification email, we're gonna be calling it again. We just got 2 emails, okay? So we check the email. It says, please click the button below to verify your email address. If you try to log in without verifying, it's telling you to verify. So I can log out, I can try to log in again. And I get that, hey, you need to verify. So once we verify, we're logged in. We have access to the dashboard. We have access to our profile. And as you can see, it has all the functionality I was mentioning, that you get to do the two-factor authentication. You get control to your sessions. You can delete your account from here. And everything comes right out of the box. So that's pretty cool. And now that we have this, I'm just gonna do a little quick thing that I like to do for this, is that I don't like typing the URL for my app. So I'm changing the logo of the view to go to my app when I click on it. It's just something stupid. I mean, you have to do it correctly in your apps, but in here it's just to show how it works. So to finish up, I'm gonna be creating the favorites functionality. For that, I'm gonna need a database table for favorites. I'm gonna need a model that takes control to, like that helps me work with the favorites. And I'm gonna need a controller to do the managing and the, give the functionality directly. So for that, another beauty of Laravel is that I'm gonna create the three things with just one command. So if we go here and we check that PHP artisan make model, if we ask for help, it's gonna show us that we can make it, when we create the model, we can create a controller, we can create a migration, and we can tell it that the controller should be a resource controller. So it's pretty cool. I'm gonna do that directly. And in Laravel, for the models, the whole tables thing and stuff like that, it uses a basic naming convention that helps for this kind of stuff. So I'm gonna call it make model. I want a controller. I want it to be resourceful, and I also want a migration created. And the models use the naming convention that if you have a plural like favorites, the model is going to be favorite. So this way, a lot of things work automatically without having to specify tables, specify relationship keys and things like that. So if we do this, it's gonna be creating favorite. It's creating, as you can see, it created the migration favorites table. It automatically gave it the plural for the table. And if we go to our files, we're gonna see that the controller is the favorite controller. So pretty cool. First, we're gonna go to our migrations. They are all always named by timestamp, so our newest migration is the last one. And we have two things here that we want to create. We're gonna be adding two columns to our database, our SQLite database, and that is the relationship to the users table, where we set up that this user set up this specific favorite, and the slot for the Pokemon we're gonna be favoriting. And when we go to, well, this is the migration, and I'm directly gonna run it. So PHP run migration again. I'm sorry, PHP artisan and migrate. Sometimes I'm too fixed on NPM, so I'm always doing run. So NPM, PHP artisan migrate, we have the table created. And then we're gonna go to our user model to work on the relationship. What we're gonna do here in the model, we have the user model. We're gonna create a method to specify the relationship we wanted to have with the favorite model. So we're gonna create a function. Oh, yes. Function favorites, because we want them It's a script tip that we want them to have many favorites by user. It's not going to be just one favorite. And what we're going to do here is just add one line. Let's return this. This comes from the model, the parent class has many. And since we're in the same namespace, I'm gonna also take advantage of that and use favorite class. Instead of having to specify the whole namespace of the class I wanna use. So with that done, the favorite model, we don't have to do anything, but we can create a function that is the inverse of this relationship. Well, you can, if from one favorite you can get the user, but it's pretty useless like that because we already have that on the user. We're not going to be doing the inverse, but it helps, for example, if you're dealing with posts and comments and things like that, where you have more interaction with the other relationship, it helps to have a way to go backwards in the relationship ladder. And we're gonna go now to the favorite controller. The favorite controller, we don't need a lot of things. We're just gonna be using the create. We'll just use this controller to create the favorite. It's not the create method. The create method is just used to show the display the formulary, the form or whatever you're gonna use to do this. But okay, you can also Diego, you can also do a PR if you want. It's a public repo, and I will be more than happy to accept your PR to fix that. It's a store method we're going to be using. So the rest of the methods we're not going to use. We could use the destroy to remove a favorite, but for the practicality of this workshop, we're just going to be going with this. So what we want to do with this is that we want to have access to the output side. So we're going to do the same as we did before. Pass out auth. And also access to the model. I'm sorry. Okay, I messed something up, but I don't know what it is. Ah, I have it closed. Okay. Actually the controller had it already set up, so I didn't have to do that. So if we have access to that, we have access to the request. We're just gonna do a quick, this method is gonna be used when someone says, hey, I want to favorite this Pokemon, add it to my favorites list. So we're just gonna be checking first that the session we're using, please mute your microphone. The user is using the session. With this method, we get the whole data of the user. We will also be receiving the in the request which Pokemon wants to be favorited by the user, and we're gonna create the model. Okay, so we have the favorite, we create a new model and we assign the properties. This could be a lot more straightforward, but I wanna do this like that to be very descriptive of how it works, okay? So we have it like this. In the, as you saw in the migration, we have a user ID, which is in direct relationship with the user model, and we have a slot. We also have an ID and a timestamps fields, but these are populated automatically when you create, when you save a new model. So you don't have to worry about doing that. It's pretty straightforward. If you want to do something special with these fields, then you can populate them by yourself, but you don't have to. So we go back here and favorite user ID is going to be our user model ID, and the favorite slug is pretty much the slug. Sometimes I hate it. Yeah. And then we go to save the model. This is pretty much how you create a model, the long and suffering way. You can, in your model, you can set up default writable columns for each model, and you can just send an array with the data by itself as different values, and it populates them automatically instead of going value by value. But in this case, I wanted to show very descriptively how we're gonna do this. And we're gonna return a redirection that it sends me back to where it came from. Okay, so we're gonna receive the request, we're gonna process it, and then we're gonna send them back to where they came from. This is how it's gonna work in here. We have the method done. What I wanna do now is create the route to access this functionality. So we're gonna go to our route. There is a special route way to do this. When you work with resources, where you create the route, instead of setting a verb, you set resource and just set like the base name. I usually use the table's name. So favorites in plural. That's my way of doing things. You can do it in singular or whatever you prefer. But I go by favorites, and then you just have to set up the class that will be handling this. And if I set it up like this, you're creating all the possible verbs and sending them to the possible methods in a resource controller. So that's pretty cool. We only have one method. In this case, it would have been the same pretty much to create the post method. But just wanted to show this off. And you can restrict a resource routing setup by specific method. So in this case, for example, we're just using the store method. You can set it up like this and say, I'm just gonna be using the store method. So all the other methods won't be accessible. You're still protecting your app. So we have the route set, we have the controller set. We're gonna work on creating the button to add your favorites. And that would be it. I'm just gonna make it simple. We're gonna go to the index file where we have all our Pokemon shown. And I'm just gonna put a button next to each Pokemon that says favorite. I want it as a favorite. And the way we're gonna be doing this is in here in the loop, we're gonna make a conditional. Oh, let me check one second. Yeah, we're already getting the user data. Remember that we're using it for the header that shows the login and register buttons. So we are already getting the user data. So we can put a conditional here. If we're getting the user, if we have a user set up, then in this case, we want to show this. For the store method, we have to create a post request. So I'm gonna create a quick form action that goes to favorites. And the method is post. That's pretty much the method. You do have to set up your token. Since we're working with sessions, and Laravel has a built-in lock to help you secure your app so you don't get requests from other domains or from that somebody captures the data and sends it as a different user, things like that. So you have the CSRF built-in command into Blake. And this will generate a hidden tag with the session token. So this way you're secure and your form will go through without a problem. So we set that up. I'm gonna put as an input, a hidden input, the slot of the Pokemon we want to favorite. So it's slot value. We're gonna set it up to be the Pokemon name. And that's pretty much for the hidden bot, the hidden input. And we're gonna create the button. It's gonna be a submit button. We're gonna add it a quick class. Since I'm using Bootstrap, we can make it not look so ugly. So we have this, and I'm sorry. That's how we got the button set up. Give me a second. I gotta close the form. So there it is. If we go back to our index, we're gonna see. No, we're not getting the data. Sorry, guys. Oh, no, because we were using the facade. Sorry. Let's go to the controller. We go to the Pokemon controller. We wanna get the user. So give me user. Give me user. But in this case, I gotta add the facade. In this case, I could get this, but if it isn't set up, I would like to get a false boolean, because we're evaluating if the user is set up in the view. So I'm just gonna do a quick ternary operation, the check, the check method will give me access to know if it is logged in or not. If it is, then give me the user data. And if it isn't, give me false. So we have it like that. We have to send it to the view. And now we should work. It is working. We have each one of the Pokemon with access to its details. And we can add it as a favorite. If we set a favorite, it went, sent the form, came back, and we have the favorite. Let me set it up to display it, obviously. And to display it, since we already set up the method in the user to have access to the favorites, it's pretty easy to just go into the index view in the same one. To make it quick, we go to the index Before the pagination, let's do it after the pagination. Before everything. If we go here, we can set up a little conditional, and we can set if user favorites count it's over 0, then we can show the whole favorite thing we want to set up. So we can give it a little title. And then do a quick list. I used to work on front end, so I got this annoying tradition of setting IDs every time and stuff like that. So now we're gonna loop over the favorites we have in the user. For each user, favorites has favorite. We're gonna, let me also close this one because we're gonna create a list item which has the, well, we can set up the same link as here. But we do have a different naming thing here, right? So we have to set it up as favorite and slot. Same here. So if we go back here and we reload, we have the favorite I had selected. Previously, we cannot resort, we cannot hit real, and we'll be having any other. So that's pretty much what I wanted to show. This is the app working. Let's go back to my super slides. I should have been showing the agenda every time I change stuff, but I didn't. So Q&A. An important note I want to quickly note after the Q&A, it'd be nice if you guys wanna hang out and do a little networking, it'd be also cool. So keep that in mind. So don't leave right after finishing the questions, but that's pretty much about the coding workshop stuff. So I don't know if you can, I don't know if you want to ask any questions. I don't know if I have any pending questions. Barry or anyone out there, do you guys know if I'm missing something that was asked before? No? The cricket sound. So does anyone have, you can unmute your microphone now. You can ask a question directly. It's not a problem, and we can talk about that.
There exists a way to use Vue or something like that with like separate the front end and the back end in this app?
I'm sorry, what?
I don't know, you can hear me, yeah. Okay, there is exists a way to separate the front end like Vue or React or Angular and the back end?
Totally. Laravel is very usable with React. I haven't done it so much because I have never used React myself. I'm not a React developer. But I know there is a way, and there is also a lot of already set up for other front-end engines like Tailwind, CSS, and that kind of stuff. Maybe Barry has more information or someone else. I'm not such a React expert, but I know that there is context where you can separate it like that, where you can have your backend set up in a way and then interacts with the front end separately as you would do in React. I don't know if that helps a little, but
yeah, that helps. But just not only React, I ask about Vue, like maybe do a backend API and consuming with a front end technology, something like that.
Totally. For example, before Wiseline, I used to work making real estate. I still do making real estate websites, and we did a pretty cool website where we had two different Laravel servers. And since we did the front end had also a lot of backend, or what we call the front end server, had a lot of functionality or backend functionality, that the user accounts and stuff like that. But we created a separate server that manage all the listings and properties and stuff like that, and was syncing constantly and things like that. And it was a separate server, an API only server, that was its only purpose was to consume data and use it in the other setup.
I haven't done this myself, but if you're using Laravel Jetstream as Jacob did, it does have official support for Vue.js. I'll drop a link in the chat.
Yeah, in fact, you were mentioning like Jetstream was like for authentication and 2FA, and I was asking about if you can use Jetstream in an API authentication, but someone in chat answered me that it's not possible right now. I don't know in the future. So maybe I'm going to still using Passport for my API authentication.
Yeah, for example, if you go to the documentation directly, you do have all this information, and there is explicitly a point. I don't remember where that was. This is the new documentation for Laravel 8, but there was specifically this question where they talk about API here it is. Laravel's API authentication services, they still recommend using Passport and Sanctum. Sanctum was also installed when I installed Jetstream, and it pretty much handles the whole database and token authentication, the sessions and stuff like that. So my guess, I'm not so sure, since I haven't gotten in depth with Laravel 8 except for this workshop, is that it uses Sanctum for the same things, using Passport for API, I don't know, bearer tokens or whatever you use for your authentication. And in the case of the front-end authentication, it uses Jetstream. Is that okay?
Yeah, sorry, thanks. No, thanks so much.
You're welcome. Any other questions?
Yeah, I had a question. So to interact with databases, Laravel has like a built-in solution or ORM that fits for all the kind of databases like Postgres, MySQL, Mongo.
Yeah.
Or do you need to use like an extra library for each one?
No. Laravel has an abstraction layer for interacting with databases, and it's called Eloquent. Actually, we saw a little tiny piece of what Eloquent is when I set up the method in the user model. When I told it to have a favorites method that would look for this relationship between the favorite and the user table, this was Eloquent working. It would be exactly the same if I had been using MySQL, in this case, SQLite, or whatever your database of choice was. So you pretty much can work however you want, and the abstraction layers does the heavy lifting for you.
Okay, awesome. Thank you.
Thanks.
Sorry, another question.
Yeah, sure.
You can use like, what's the name? Like sockets in Laravel 2 for show some notifications like in real time, something like that. I don't remember the name of that.
Yeah, I mean, you can have that kind of connection. It'd be like working with some kind of the API. I would have to look exactly in the documentation. I did give it a read through to some stuff of the documentation, and I do remember having subpens. Ah, there you go, Laravel Echo. Laravel Echo is your answer.
Okay, thank you. The question about Mongo reminds me something like that. So, thank you so much.
Yeah, sure. This is it. So yeah, that's cool. Thanks, Miguel Angel. Do you have any more questions? Please don't forget this. This is a survey. It helps a lot. I don't work. I mean, my job is not doing this kind of stuff. So don't be afraid to be critical of what you put in the feedback. It really is to help me. I do want to improve as a facilitator, as a presenter, as a host. So if you think I messed horribly in something, okay. Ah, okay, yeah, sorry, but it works in the feedback survey. Yeah, so what I was saying, my job is not evaluated by how I get feedback on this. This is only to improve as a facilitator. So please don't be afraid to say you suck completely at X or Y thing during the workshop. Please be honest, be very critical. Obviously, don't say ugly things just because you want to say them. Be constructive, but be really honest. It really is to help me. I really appreciate that you're honest and that you help me do this. Which following steps would you recommend to keep learning Laravel? The first thing, dig into the documentation. The beauty about Laravel is that the documentation is so complete. Anything you want to look into, if you Google anything about Laravel, I'm almost 90% sure that the first results you will get will be from the documentation. So dig into the documentation, even if there are a lot of stuff you're not going to be using, it is really set up as way of looking into specific functionalities and things like that. It's not very technical, it's more built as in a tutorial way. It is very verbose, it's very easy to understand. So dig into the documentation, and once you're there, there is this other platform that shows a lot of tutorials, not only Laravel, but PHP in general, which is Laracasts. Laracasts is a very cool let me finish this. Laracasts is really cool. It has a ton of tutorials. It's paywall. You have to pay for it, but it really is worth it. You have a lot of, since starting, I mean, if you're an awesome super PHP developer, you may not need a lot, but people like me that have strengths and weaknesses, you can go in there and check tutorials for basic object-oriented programming on PHP, PHP katas, building different kind of apps from the ground up, regular expressions, there are a ton of things focused on PHP and more stuff on Laravel. So it's pretty cool. I really recommend it. But first and foremost, the documentation. I'm sorry. The documentation is awesome. It's like the Arch Linux of frameworks documentation. It's pretty cool. And with the JetStream model, would you be able to manage user profiles and authorization level, access levels as well? Yeah, you do. And you would have to work a few things on your own. I'm not sure that the user roles or levels are easily or out of the box set up, but you can, it's really customizable how you can work with these kind of modules. So they're not just to use if you have this specific use case that I showed, but it's really customizable and really easy to create a lot of functionality that you may need in the future. Love Laravel, but it's always nice to know other options. So what other PHP frameworks do you like? My first is Laravel. I just heard about this cool new one called, let me check. Yeah, I have never heard about it, but chatting in the PHP Jalisco Telegram group, they talked about this awesome framework called Falcon. I'm gonna put the link for the Larcast here as well. This is the one I mentioned about the tutorials. And this one, this other framework, I haven't used it yet, but looks awesome. other than that, I use the, I don't remember the name of the, Lumen, the light version of Laravel. I find it pretty easy to use to create commands and stuff like that. But before Laravel, I pretty much used CodeIgniter. But I don't do that at all anymore. there are things, depending on the complexity of the project, obviously you don't always need the full-blown Laravel thing. For that kind of stuff, it wasn't meant to bash on CodeIgniter. I just meant that I'm so in love with Laravel after using it that I haven't looked back into using CodeIgniter after that. But it's not, CodeIgniter helped me and my career grow up when I first started, and it's pretty cool. And I heard they have a year or a couple of years since they started making it better. So that's pretty cool. But I just fell out of the loop with CodeIgniter, so I stopped following it. But I use Laravel, Lumen when I want lighter stuff. And if I go even lighter, just use PHP. I mean, bootstrap your own app, your own tiny app with Composer, and create your classes you need, make it get some dependencies for security, and that's pretty much all you need if you're going really small. But for medium stuff and things like that, Lumen works great. And for big apps, Laravel is the bomb. It's very useful and super fast for the huge thing it is. Which continuous integration stack do you usually use, and within which cloud, if any? To be honest, PHP, I haven't done a lot of big work in Wiseline. Actually, all the work I have done on Wiseline has been on TypeScript and JavaScript. So I haven't had the opportunity to really use big project stuff on PHP. But what can I tell you? I mean, when I was working on my own, when I was a freelancer working on Laravel and that kind of stuff, I pretty much worked with how GitLab helped me get the continuous integration pipeline set up, you know? I mean, I have never been a fan of really making it more complicated than it can be. And I have always found that GitLab has a nice, like, default templates to make it done. So I can really give much expertise on that because I haven't been able to see what they do here in Wiseline about that with PHP. In my company, we're starting to use the JSON API specification and we have encountered some challenges. Have you ever used it and do you think that it works to implement it? I'm not sure I'm completely familiar with that. If you mean that the API works completely with JSON requests and responses, is that it? Okay, give me a second to look it up. Well, yeah, I think it's pretty much what I meant. Do you think that it works to implement it? I love working with JSON. It's pretty easy, no matter the language you're working with. It's beautiful. And I really, really automatically hate any service that gives me XML or something like that as a response. I do use JSON a lot, and when consuming APIs, if I get JSON, I totally would do that. Let me go up because there are a few other things in my company. I don't know if you know API platform made in Symfony. Is there an alternative in Laravel? Miguel Angel, does this mean if it's possible to develop an API on Laravel, or what's the question? I'm not sure I'm understanding it correctly. You can unmute your microphone if you can. Or if you're...
I just get about the platform, like a API platform. It's a few tools. Building in the dot or Symfony to make an API to Diego mentioned it, is JSON API and another standard could be building on the dot or
yeah, go ahead, I'm listening. I mean, it is possible and totally doable to create an API on Laravel. You have API platform, it's the name of a specific framework.
Yes, it's the name of the tool.
And it is built on top of Symfony, you mentioned?
Yeah.
I guess there could be like packages or components already written for Laravel to have an API like ready. But in my experience, it is already pretty easy to set up an API app on Laravel out of the box. I mean, you don't need to do much to have an API up and running on Laravel.
Thank you.
Yeah, no problem. And I had another one here. Do you think it's worth the investment of time learning Laravel PHP when so many people are focusing now on other technologies or have a bad opinion on PHP? Oof, yeah, this is a good one. I don't hold an engineer bachelor degree. I started marketing and then did graphic design and communication. I learned to develop on my own. And I did what I could do with what I had on hand like 12 years ago, which was PHP. It was pretty easy to learn. And that's why I went with PHP. But it does have a bad reputation. And I think the bad reputation from PHP comes from the early versions of PHP, which were not on par with other languages that as good as it could have been. The advantage of PHP back then was that it was widely used It was widely available. Everyone could have a website up and running with PHP in minutes because every host already supported PHP because of WordPress. And a huge percentage of the web is on WordPress or on PHP. Pretty much all on WordPress, but a huge amount is on PHP. The investment of learning that against other languages, I don't know. I can't give you an opinion there because I don't like bashing on other languages or comparing. There is a lot of jobs and work for PHP devs. There is, as well as there are for others. Right now, we're having a high demand for software engineers in Wiseline, and it's huge. I'm helping doing interviews, and it's huge how many interviews you get for PHP developers, JavaScript developers, .NET developers. So there is a lot of work for everyone. If you fancy the language, if you like how Laravel works, if you find it interesting, it is totally worth the time. You will get work as a freelancer or developing in a company. You will find stuff to do. It has more to do with how you are as a professional and how you do things than the language you use, in my opinion. But I do think it's worth the investment if you feel like it's something that goes with you. I would recommend it. It has its advantages and disadvantages as any other language. I like it. I like other languages too. But for example, I fell in love with TypeScript recently, but PHP 8 is coming now and it has a lot of the beautiful things that made me fall in love with TypeScript. So you have to decide for yourself. I like it. I have invested a lot of time on it and I have found job and put food on the table because of Laravel. It has helped me, but it's up to you completely to do it or not. Have you worked with clean architecture with PHP? What do you think? The same opinion I have from when I said why PHP has a bad rep. I think before it was full of bad practices, even inconsistencies of naming methods and things like that. Right now it's a lot better. It's a lot easier. Composer also changed the whole view of how to create a PHP app, calling and installing dependencies and keeping it tidy, creating like the pre-compiling and stuff like that. So I do like it. I do like it now. It's a lot easier. It's a lot more tidy and clean, and it's getting better. Barry a few weeks ago gave a talk about what's coming for PHP 8. It was an awesome talk, and the things that are coming are awesome. And actually you can look to install PHP 8 in your computer right now. There is a release candidate, I think, that you can use. And actually in the Wiseline YouTube channel, you can find Barry's talk and you can see what's coming. It's pretty cool. What folders do you need to publish your app? Do you need Node in your production server? No, I'm going for with the last question first. The NPM and things like that that are working when you do the NPM installing your server are for all for front-end things. So you don't need Node in your server to run a Laravel app, even for the Jetstream thing and stuff like that. What folders do you need to publish your app? The default ones. I'm not sure I understand the question, but the ones you installed, you don't need to do anything else to have your app published. And as I said, the domain or the endpoint that goes to your website should go to the public folder. It shouldn't go to the root of your project. What tools do you recommend to static analysis? I'm not so familiar with static analysis. If you could elaborate. I'm sorry, I'm not so shy of saying, I don't know what you're talking about, but let me check. Also called static code analysis, a method of debugging that is done by examining the code without executing the program. Is that like testing, I guess? Oh, there you have a couple questions. Oh, three questions. Okay, I see what it is now. This is what happens when you don't study as an engineer. Then you get questions. That's it. I don't know if anybody has any more questions. Paul, nice. Let's do Paul's. Shoot. What is the best language? A, PHP, B. Nice. You missed D, all of the above. Come on, everybody, bold. This is pretty much my experience with Laravel. This is pretty much how I see things. I like it. I hope you like the talk. And also I wanted to see if anyone wants to share if you have any experience with Laravel or with PHP, with the community. I mean, I think there is a lot of PHP Jalisco people here. So, and if you haven't done so, please go to the feedback to check what's up. But if anyone wants to take the microphone, wants to share your experience or something like that, you're more than welcome. Let me copy the link to stop sharing and we can see all each other if you have your cameras on. There you go. Nobody's using their camera. Nice. Let me put the feedback link here. Yeah, I will. Give me a second. There you go. Yeah, tell me, Ayen. Thank you, Ismael. That's pretty nice of you. You can unmute too. Oh, okay, I have just started Node.js. I would like to integrate it into a Laravel project. And I would therefore like to know if I should start two servers at once, one for Laravel and one for Node. I mean, you can run it simultaneously if you're using different ports, but I don't know what the use case would be to have two different servers running. I don't know if you can give me more details or if anyone has a use case that could be using this kind of situation. Or is this just for practice to learn? I'm not sure. I mean, if it was to learn or to like compare how the two work doing pretty much the same functionality or something like that, I would run them, I would do Docker containers. I don't know. I have to integrate real-time chat. And you're using one of the servers to do one thing and the other another thing? Or, I mean, my guess is you can do real. The only scenario that I know for that is covered by Laravel Echo. Yeah. Oh, okay, the sockets, real-time chat. Okay, yeah. Well, as Javier says, you can use Laravel Echo and it does the whole handling of the socket of Node.js server on its own. So you don't have to worry about that. But if you want to do it on your own, you can customize your Ready server to do whatever you need for it to do the Node.js thing on its own. Actually, I think there is a very like bare bones way of integrating Redis into your Laravel installation, where you set up environment variables, and then it starts working with the Redis server. So that way you don't let Laravel do a lot of the work, but you do things separated and just let them communicate with the setup in the environment variables. I think. I have never done it, but sounds feasible. No problem. You're welcome. And thank you, Javier. That was very helpful. So I don't know if there are more questions. There are a few people still here. Does anyone have any more questions? Just wanted to share a little, or if you have any questions about Wiseline specifically. Okay, if you need to run two projects on the same server, you can have both and assign a different port and then use a proxy with Apache or anything. Yeah, totally. That's what I meant with running on different ports. And it's totally doable. And Nginx, it's super easy to use. Yeah, actually microservices is really cool. And there is a huge boom right now also internally in Wiseline where there's a lot of talk about it. Actually, I don't know if he's here, but there was this, no, he's not. But there is an engineer that talks about microservices, but he didn't join. Yep.
Here's Mael. I think that all the solution that are providing the people that is in here and is writing in the chat is good and are good. And also you mentioned that we can use Docker. I think in this moment, because the technology is really good with Docker and everyone is adopting Docker, I suggest to learn Docker and use start Dockerizing, start learning about that and using proxy also for your microservices. Because Nginx is just part of the infrastructure. So I think Docker can give you more a strong knowledge about how you can handle your requests between your front end and back end. I feel that most of the people is here is full stack developers, which means that you can handle tasks from back end and front end. So basically, I suggest to start learning both. It's really awesome, and there are some free courses in YouTube channel that can help you to reach those goals and manage best practices. Doing also deployments is really easy to manage with Docker.
Totally, and I couldn't agree more. I came to Wiseline without knowing so much about Docker, and actually the project I'm in, we have been using a lot of Docker, and I learned, I can't use swear words, but I learned a ton of the whole setup and security practices doing containerization and Docker file builds and stuff like that. It's super awesome and really, really helpful to also visualize how the system is going to be working with your app.
Yeah, because you're basically creating your infrastructure, a similar infrastructure that you are going to be working on the deployments that use the two or three different environments. You have isolated containers for front end, other for back end, other for database, and so on. You can have different services running in containers, and when you grow up and you start managing an orchestrator like Kubernetes, you can easily handle the deployments, and it's not like the old-fashioned way that when you have your VPS and you are deploying the backend, and then you go to another VPS and deploy the front end, and then the third VPS to deploy the changes on databases. This way is really easy, and you understand the basis, and how to write your Yammer files and your Docker configuration files, you will be a better developer.
Totally, totally. And it gives you what you mentioned, a lot of insight, a lot of the panorama of setting things up. So totally, totally, totally agree with you. That's great. And it's great that you brought the subject up, because in the more informal PHP environment, it is not talk about Docker so much. So it is very, very useful and really, really on point that you mentioned it. Thank you. Awesome insight. Five stars.
I have a question.
Thank you. Tell me, Diego.
Yes, do you know any platform for get freelance Laravel jobs?
Oh, no. I have, when I was personally, I don't know if anyone can share links on the chat, but personally, when I was a freelance, when I worked 11 years on my own, when I worked as a freelance, I always had the luck of pretty much doing everything running through my professional network. That's the advantage of not having studied engineering, was that none of the people I knew from college developed. So anytime anyone needed anything, they would come directly to me. And that's how I started building my professional network. But in this case, for example, right now, this is why PHP Jalisco, this is why Wiseline is also looking for more talent, why we give this kind of workshops, because we want to get everyone together. I mean, it's awesome to do this kind of work. Getting to join companies like Wiseline is pretty cool as well. So I getting jobs in Laravel, I do think we have projects internally, like clients that ask for Laravel development and PHP. There are for sure a few, since they hired people like me and Barry. But in general, there is, and my suspicion is that there will still be a lot of jobs for Laravel. I don't know, my suggestion would be to hang around in this kind of meetups, do networking, showcase a lot of things you do, try to keep showing what you do. And if that's what you're looking for, what kind of technologies is Wiseline looking for in engineers? Any, pretty much any. I mean, not any, there is not a lot of Rust engineer demanding Wiseline, but JavaScript, JavaScript, TypeScript, Node, .NET, PHP, Go, Golang. I'm missing a lot, but if you can program, if you feel yourself Java as well, Java, JavaScript, .NET, Python 2, I would really encourage you to apply. And if you at the beginning of the chat, you saw my Twitter handle. I'm gonna share it here again. If you have any questions, if you want to join Wiseline but are not so sure of how to do or how the process goes or whatever, I'm totally into this was a different email. I just sent you a quick email about your slides. I don't know where you sent it. I don't think it was to my Google email. Was it to Academy? If you can send me, I put my Twitter handle on top. If you can send me something, I can fix them more. And If you send it to Academy, I don't have access to that. But what I was saying, if you want to join Wiseline, if you're looking for an opportunity or something like that, do it. I meet a lot of people that are not so sure because they want to train more or they want to feel more secure doing algorithm problems or stuff like that. I started my process in Wiseline because Wiseline reached out to me, and because of my GitHub account of the open source work I had been doing, and they reached out. I said, I don't need to. I was working on my own. I was doing great, but I did want to see how I would do in a technical interview. So that's why I accepted to take the interview. But once I did the on-site, once I went to the offices and met people and did the back-to-back interviews and stuff like that, I fell in love with Wiseline. It was like, no, well, I'm just gonna go see if I'm good enough to pass. And at the end of the onset, I was really, really, really hoping for an offer, and it happened. So my point is that don't worry too much. And if you don't pass, if you don't get accepted, Wiseline is very proactive on giving feedback, on encouraging you to develop your skills and try again later. So I wouldn't hold to, if there's free beer in Friday at Wiseline, just joking. Actually, there is free beer every day once we get back to the office. But yeah, there are fridges with beer all day. I mean, it's a very relaxed environment. It's pretty cool. It's pretty easy, but it is also very ownership centered. They expect you to do your stuff, do your work, give workshops. No, just kidding, but to try to help each other. The good thing about Wiseline too is that I had never heard about TypeScript before I entered Wiseline, and I learned in 2 weeks with a Udemy course and had all the support from my teammates and other people in Wiseline. The whole environment is that if you have any questions, or you know I know a lot about something, ask me, reach out. The Slack is beautiful. The Wiseline Slack workspace is beautiful because there is always a lot of activity and a lot of giving and a lot of good vibe and stuff. It's really cool. It's really, really cool. So yeah, can you share more details about the interview process or give a link with more information, please? For the available roles, you should go into the Academy, Wiseline.com website, and there is an open roles section. The interview process, it changes from time to time, but for technical, for software engineers, which is what I know, you get a few problems, I think, like virtually, you get sent links to solve some problems. And if you solve them correctly, or at least show a train, like a thought process of doing things right, like giving a good effort and like having a good solving problem train of thought, then you get passed on to a technical interview with an engineer. And I'm not so sure how many interviews are there right now. I do sometimes do technical interviews, but that's about it. Since I'm not in recruiting, I'm not so sure how it works right now. But that's how it happens. You interview with engineers after you... Oh, thank you, Bernardo. There are the open rules. Oh, and right now we're looking for people where there are offices, but also remote. Barry, for example, is connecting from Canada, and even when we return to the offices, he will still be working remote. So there are remote roles open, and we're looking. Wiseline is really focused right now on getting the talent wherever it is, not trying to get the talent over where we are, but really get people that have a good fit with this open, friendly, honest, own ownership center culture, and so we can all work together and build awesome stuff together. Okay, I received a message about getting a copy of the slides. I mean, there is not a lot of information there, but sure. I will be sending an email to everyone that registered. I will be sending an email with a link of the repo, again, the feedback form in case you didn't fill it today, or for the people that left early. But, and also I will add the slides, it's not a problem. I will add them as an attachment to the email. But you will still be receiving annoying stuff from Jakub. So don't worry about that. I don't know if you have any more questions about Laravel, about working at Wasteland, or about technology in general, or something like that.
I have understanding that you are working on remote right now for pandemic situation, but it is possible after this pandemic works like remote or something?
Yeah, as I said, for example, Barry, he's been with us like for a couple months now, I think, something like that, right, Barry? And there are more open roles as remote. Actually, in the link, you can see in the chat that Bernardo shared, there are open roles and you would directly apply there. I'm also on LinkedIn. If you want, you can look for me on LinkedIn. And let me get my profile. And we can totally set a time for a video chat or whatever if you have questions about this. We're happy to meet people and meet people that want to work with us. So it'd be awesome if you have doubts about how things work. Give me a second. There you go. That's my LinkedIn profile. You can add me as a contact, and we can chat or by Twitter or whatever. And yeah, I mean, if you have questions, if you're not so sure on what to talk about your skills or whatever you do, we can also. Oh, it'd be nice to. Thank you, Ismail. It'd be nice if you guys want to share your Twitter username so we can keep on looking at each other in our timelines. I share a lot of stupid stuff on Twitter as well, so don't expect too much tech on my Twitter timeline, but always happy to connect with other people. And yeah, I mean, if you want, you can add me on LinkedIn and look for me or contact me through Twitter. If you have doubts about your skills, if you want to talk, if you want to talk tech in general, PHP, Laravel, questions about the workshop, whatever, I'm totally open and willing to keep chatting. It'd be nice. Thanks a lot, guys. Nice workshop. I am open to discuss anything about programming and also another stuff. See you. For the ones leaving now, thank you. And I don't know if there are any more questions or you want to chat about anything else. So cool that you guys are, I'm sorry, you guys, that everyone is sharing this kind of stuff. So cool.
I have a question. There will be Laravel workshops in the future?
Yeah, we plan to do a lot of PHP stuff. I mean, not only Laravel, but we want to do a lot more of PHP. I mean, we're a little team of developers that really like PHP inside Wasteland. I mean, there are a lot of PHP developers, but we want to push it a little further. the whole PHP Academy thing. So we might be bothering you in the near future to join us for more PHP workshops or talks. I mean, for example, the talk Barry gave, it was a talk, it wasn't a workshop. So it was very interesting to see the differences happening in the screen and more in-depth explanation of how things work instead of just watching this guy type, but like more documented and explained. So it was pretty cool. Okay. And actually there are more wiseliners right now here. So I don't know if you have any more questions for them as well. They trash PHP like the rest of the people, but they're nice people. Well, if there is nothing else, I can wait a little. Lol. Hello, well. Yeah, if there is nothing else, but not this one of them. If there is nothing else, we can finish the workshop. 15 minutes late, so that's a success. I expected to finish at 9 p.m. or something like that. Just 15 minutes over, it's cool. It was great having you all here, meeting you. I hope I can see many of you in the future in Wiseline, or at least in other talks. Keep it up. Good vibes, and have a nice evening.